This week at the Internet Cafe, War on the Web. If you're a war history buff, check out the online War Times Journal. If you're into war games, meet Ed Allen. He runs a site called Ed's Hobby Hovel for the latest in war board games. If real-time strategy war games is your thing, we'll show you the hottest new online multiplayer war game called Dark Reign. For the veterans of real wars, the web is one way to find old buddies and remember the fallen. And if you're not into war at all, we'll show you one website, the Plowshares Fund, that's working for peace. War on the Web, this week at the Internet Cafe. NetCafe is made possible by RonDiamond.com, the oldies site on the Internet. Music and memories from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, not just another jukebox. Additional support comes from the law offices of Ivan Hoffman, lawyering with integrity for internet law, copyright, trademark, and other intellectual property law. And by TechWeb for up-to-the-minute technology news. So we're talking about war on the web, and there's a lot of guys I know who are really into the war thing. I mean, they go back and recreate the Civil War and World War I and World War II, and they just love playing with this war stuff and the web.
Stewart, who have you been hanging out with?
These are not my friends. Okay. These are just people I know. No, seriously, a lot of people are into this. I'm not that interested in it, but the web is just full of this stuff. Do you find this boring, all this war stuff?
Well, I'd hazard a guess that the both of you think that I don't like it at all.
War.
Yeah.
Well,
I'm against it. But no, actually, I think some of it's kind of interesting when you think about the historical aspects and how we dealt with the whole issue of strategy and those types of things. I think there's some elements of it that are interesting, but I think the preoccupation with it is a little off the edge.
Well, I guess there's two sides, Andrew. I mean, there's historical stuff, studying the old wars. That's not
right.
So bad, but a lot of websites are about war today and how to make war and stuff like that.
Well, there's sort of an interesting paradox. I mean, the internet actually, as we know, was founded as sort of a research,
defense
a communication tool
right.
for the Defense Department. And there's now also sites that are looking at the history, but there's also sites that are looking at peace and how to spread peace throughout the world. So I think they're using the tools of the web to do that.
So, right, we'll see both sides.
Right. No conversation about war on the web would be complete without a historical look at war and archiving it on the web.
Mm-hmm.
What have you done on the War Times Journal to sort of preserve it and educate people?
Well, we have a lot of online archives from that are written by people who actually experienced these things.
Mm-hmm.
They were in the fighting. They were in World War I. They were in the Civil War.
Famous people, I'm assuming.
Yeah, General Longstreet, the Red Baron.
Von Richthofen.
It turns out Von Richthofen wrote a book before he died in 1917. And so that's coming online now at our site.
So you've actually taken that book and transcribed it?
We're transcribing it.
Okay.
And we've also got one of his contemporaries was Eddie Rickenbacker.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you ever heard of him. He was an American fighter pilot during World War I. He's very famous. And we've got his memoirs are also online right next to Richthofen's.
So you can go on there and read the whole thing.
Exactly. Or you can look at Nelson's orders to the British fleet before Trafalgar.
Really?
Napoleon's correspondence or Wellington's dispatches.
Right. Now, I was looking at the Napoleon's dispatches, and I was having a little hard time reading
because
it was in French. Right.
Yeah.
So
we're working on getting it in English,
but
that's a little bit slower. The 32 volumes of it are all in French.
Wow.
So we're making bits and pieces of it available now in French, and then we're working on getting it into English later.
You'll have all 32 volumes online? Or?
Well, I don't know if that'll happen while I'm alive.
Right, right.
But hopefully it'll happen.
Okay. Now, I also saw that people can go and actually purchase books on your site as well relating to war.
Military history, military science, Jane's, almost anything. We're trying to give a wide variety of books for people to buy.
Okay, okay. And I also saw photo collections in there as well.
A lot of those are from people who've sent us images to put
mm-hmm.
online. Or some of them are pictures we brought back from Europe of some photo plates that we found. We found about two years ago, a very rare collection of stereo glass plates from World War I. We're making those available online
now,
in their stereo format.
If I'm not mistaken, stereo, it's sort of like 3D images sort of the beginnings of 3D.
Yes. Oh, they're pure 3D images.
Okay.
So they're stunning.
And people can take a look at those.
Yeah.
Online as well. So is this a historical thing? Is this a labor of love? Is this a positive fascination with war? You know, how did you get involved?
Well, I don't know if it's a positive fascination with war, but I mean, it's something to study.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that happens.
Right.
I come from a military family all the way back to the Revolution.
Okay.
So it's sort of in my blood as far as that goes. And everyone in my family's been in wars for the last 200 years. Civil War, World War I, World War II, yeah.
To take it online. And you spend a lot of time doing this.
Yes.
I mean, I saw that site. There's a lot of work involved in that.
Yeah, we have the archives. We also have articles. Mm-hmm. We have free war games that we give away online. So it's a lot of stuff. And the articles are written for the magazine.
So you and other folks write those?
Yeah, and it all involves primary research. Primary research meaning we read eyewitness accounts as opposed to secondary research, which is just stuff that other people have said.
Right,
so to speak.
Right. So you actually may be presenting a new perspective on different battles or different heroes.
Or if we can reinforce an old one that turns out to be correct, then we do that.
As well. Yeah. Okay. Where do you see the future going for the War Times Journal?
When the internet becomes more powerful in its ability to deliver a lot of data, we want to have animated combat maps, streaming video interviews, things like that.
Okay.
We're setting up some interviews with people over in Europe, some old war veterans, for that in the future.
You'll have a real personal touch to what happened there as well.
Exactly.
Well, we're looking at war on the web, and one of the ways you can experience war on the web is to play one of the many war simulation games online that proliferate there on the net. One of the newest, best, and most realistic of these is called Dark Reign from Activision, and we have the producer of Dark Reign here. How you doing, Greg?
Good. How you doing?
For people who don't understand the difference between a shoot-em-up like a Quake and a real-time strategy game like Dark Reign or Command & Conquer Warcraft, what is the difference?
Well, primarily, the first difference is you're third person. You're no longer in the first person. So
you're not the guy with the gun.
Right. You're looking down on the battlefield, and this gives you more of a strategic advantage on the entire battlefield. So I'm no longer dealing with really what's the goal of the one individual person, which is more tactical.
Mm-hmm.
But what is my entire troops doing? What's my entire battle
situation? You're the general,
situation?
Not the soldier with
more
the gun.
More or less, exactly.
All right,
exactly.
Now people are familiar with things like Command and Conquer and Warcraft and so on. How is Dark Reign different from those?
Well, I mean, first off, I mean, we admitted that those were great games. I mean, we played them like crazy. So
right.
We took those as our foundation, and we thought, how can we make these games better? How can we make it more of a realistic war game? Well, one of the primary things we did was in the terrain effects. We wanted to make sure we have real terrain effects. Terrain effects.
And what does that mean? Why is that important?
Well, in the battle, terrain plays an important part. Gaining the high ground, making sure you have line of sight to your enemy, make sure that maybe I can see him, but he can't see me.
So
that
a 2D world is not a realistic way
Absolutely.
To play war.
Absolutely. So starting to introduce some 3D elements, still with a top-down perspective, is a big strategic factor in these war games. So that was one of the first things we did.
Okay, what else?
The terrain effects. Another thing was the unit balance. One of the great things about these games is kind of the sides and your units and what your actual pieces are and how you use them. So we had we created two very unique sides with two different ways of playing, depending on how the player likes to play. One of our sides is the Imperium. They're into these kind of big military tactics.
Mm-hmm.
They just roll over the other side. The other side, the Freedom Guard, is more into a smaller infantry-based tactics.
Now,
so two different ways of playing.
Explain this whole notion of AI, the artificial intelligence that gets built into your troops, because some of the problems of these games, you've got so much to manage, it's kind of hard to play the
game.
Right,
obviously, when you've got 50 people on the map, it's hard to really control every single one of them. Well, the computer AI is really what we started with. You know, a lot of war games up to now had not very good computer AI. That's why people wanted to play them online so much.
Yeah.
But we've created a really good computer AI that really reacts to the way that you play, constantly analyzing the situation, deciding where the strategic advantages and disadvantages are, building the appropriate troops, and then going out and attacking.
Give me an example. I mean, what kind of thing could one of my soldiers do on his own
knowing what
I want?
Well, from a computer standpoint, if I decide I want to wage an air war, okay, and he's just building up his base, he doesn't know what I'm doing, and all of a sudden I come over with some sort of aircraft, he'll acknowledge that. He'll think, he might be building more aircraft. I'm going to build some air defenses now.
So there's some smarts in there.
Exactly. There's some give and take depending on the way I play. It doesn't do the exact same thing every time.
And you can define your units. You can say, just be a scout or just do search and destroy.
Right.
What's the difference
The idea there was all these kind of benefits that we gave to the computer, we also gave to the player. So you have to micromanage every single detail of every one of these units. The problem is when you've got 50 units, it's hard to say,
Now
you go here, you do that, you do that, you do that. You can now group units and you can say, now I'd like you to perform scouting maneuvers. Go around the map
and
really
explore. So you don't
have
to micromanage every single
unit. Exactly, exactly.
All right, last question. How realistic do you think this stuff is? Can you imagine some guy at the Pentagon seeing Dark Reign and saying, hey, we're going to train our commanders because this is really like war?
Well, there's several different kinds of war games. Certainly real-time strategy, which we're in, it does introduce a lot lot of action elements. You know, it's really what keeps the game exciting. But as games move forward, I think you'll get more and more realism in. As 3D becomes more and more prevalent and better, you're going to get more effects that people are really feeling like they're in the moment, they're in the situation there. And I think we already use quite a few algorithms that are actually war algorithms for military strategic combat. So we already use those, but still being in this 2D environment kind of takes you away and kind of removes you. And plus we have to put in, you know, just it is a game. We want to make it, you know, put
some action elements in. But when you're playing the game, you can feel like you're really in the heat of battle there.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, you start to sweat, sure.
So, Ed, you've got this hobby hovel, and I've never quite seen a website with so much information about war games. Now, typically I would think of war games as sort of shoot 'em up, bang 'em up. Tell me, there's a lot more to it than that.
Right. Well, these are more strategic, tactical brain games where you're trying to maneuver forces on a map that's either a paper map or a scenery laid out with model railroad type scenery and with lead soldiers. And the idea is to outflank the other guy or to, you know, break the center, and you're rolling dice to see how the combats happen.
So now you've got a broad range of types of games, though, too. What are the different kinds of games that you've got?
Well, I've got stuff on my site ranging from some rules I wrote for playing with little clay monsters that you put together yourself to a set of rules for pushing lead soldiers, fighting man-to-man fights for the Old West or the Three Musketeers or stuff like that.
So you've got pretty broad range now. And these are some examples of some of the figurines. So for the board games where you've created this sort of railroad big setup, so you'd have to have a fairly large basement to be able to do something like this.
That's right,
And you hand-paint these. You've got information on the website about, you know, various armor colors and coats and all those different things. Help me out here, because I don't play even war games on the computer. What prompts you to do stuff like this? What is it about this stuff that you like?
It's a lot of fun painting, and it's a lot of fun seeing nice figures come out when you're done. But the games, it's your typical thrill of victory. You know, it's when you get things put together right and you win, and you really beat the guy.
Now, do you ever get really, you know, aggressive, ever kind of get punchy by the end of the night?
We try not to.
But it does get pretty intense?
You get pretty intense, and you see people yelling sometimes, yeah. But
and how long does a typical game take?
Anywhere from an hour up to 20 hours, 30
wow.
hours. The long ones are broken into segments. Yeah. Play
but it can
six
be
or eight
pretty
hours
intense.
At a time.
So for somebody who would go to your website, what are the kind of things they'd be interested in finding out about for people who are interested in these kind of games?
Well, there's historical materials from the era for the Seven Years' War for those guys. There's pictures of different kinds of troops that I painted and, you know, examples both of the painting and the different companies making them. There's a lot of stuff for a particular game, the Ancients game, the little guys there are for, called DBM.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a couple of rule sets, and there's a database for people to find each other and play the games.
So the database basically allows people to link up in various cities.
That's right.
Because the whole idea is really to get face-to-face for the most part, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. And some people play by net, too, but it's mostly face-to-face.
So what's the average age of somebody who would play this game?
35.
Yeah, so it's an older group of folks, as opposed to, you know, 14-year-olds.
Right. The computer games have siphoned off most of the youth.
Yeah.
There's a pretty good contingent of fantasy gamers coming up in their teens that you know, probably will slowly pick up some of the historical stuff.
So do you like playing video games, though, too, or computer games? Or you prefer this kind of...
I play a fair amount of computer games, mostly solo, because I don't have the time to really sit there and do it for hours on end.
It's an incredible site. I mean, just a vast amount of information for somebody who's interested in this stuff, and even for somebody like me who is just overwhelmed at the massive amount of different things that you can do. It's a great site.
And we have with us Larry Magid here in the Internet Cafe, syndicated columnist for the LA Times, contributing editor for Home PC Magazine. Larry, I want to ask you about getting news online. Increasingly, with a lot of big stories lately, people don't have the patience to wait for the morning paper, to wait for the 11 o'clock news. They're going right to the web to get their news right now, and there's an issue as to how reliable and credible is news on the net. What do you think?
Depends on your source. If you're going to a source that's reliable, like the NewYorkTimes.com or a big newspaper or company, you can probably count on the fact they're going to apply their same standards of journalism
online.
They're
the easy ones. How about these middle ones, the Drudge Report and other sites?
Yeah,
like
you know, a lot of these guys, they're rumor mongers, and Drudge is right sometimes and wrong a lot of the times. And again, you have to look at the source and say, does this guy know what he's talking about? Can I trust him? And it's just really a question of buyer beware. I mean, I can't tell you about every site, but some are great and some are very sleazy.
Aren't there cases of people intentionally putting up disinformation on the web,
though?
Oh, yeah.
People will do it just as a joke, for fun, or in some cases to deliberately deceive. And so, again, critical thinking is very important. When you're online, you've got to think critically.
Aren't journalists themselves going online and checking out some of these sites to get their own
Absolutely. Drudge is serving a lot of journalists and looking at his stuff. And I use the net as a research tool. It's a great tool. But, again, I look at it critically, and by the time I write something, I've thought about whether it's really true.
Now, you write in both worlds. You write for print, and you write for your own website, larrysworld.com. Do you yourself use a different standard writing on the web? Is it less serious than when you write for print?
The research is the same. Everything's validated in the same way, but it's more conversational. I write for the web almost like you're on radio or television. But absolutely, you've got to be accurate. It's the same standards of journalism.
But in general, reader beware.
Absolutely.
Thank
you've got to beware.
Nayla, you're from the Plowshares Fund, and from what I gather, it's a peace organization online, and that seems to be an interesting, since the origins of the web seem to have been sort of a military installation, people using the web to communicate different weapons developments, and now we have the Plowshares Fund. What's it about?
That's exactly right. Well, Plowshares Fund is actually a public foundation. And what we do is provide grants. We give funding, basically, to organizations and individuals who work on a broad range of security and peace issues globally, both here in the United States and abroad.
So you're giving out money to good causes, good peace. Now, are these all online organizations, or is it just spread all over?
It's really spread all over. And there are actually many, many that are online. And on our website, we, in fact, link to all of our grantees who have websites. But, you know, we also fund teeny little grassroots organizations that are out in Siberia or in other places in Russia, and they actually don't have access to this type of technology.
But with the funding that you're giving them,
that's what we're hoping. Actually, that is one of the grants that we gave early on, was so that they could at least communicate with each other through email. And then hopefully the next step will be to establish websites.
Right. Now, a group like yours has been around for a while. So I imagine you didn't start online. In fact, probably the Internet may not have been there even. So how has the transition been to going on the web, and how are you using it?
Well, it was difficult, I have to say. And I think some of it is because Plowshares was actually founded about 16 years ago.
So it was a long time before.
Right. And it's been one of those organizations that's kind of been a little bit like pulling teeth to get it into the information age. And some of that just had to do with there were people who weren't as familiar with technology.
Right.
So our site is actually fairly new. It's only been up and really operating well for about a year.
Okay.
And I think it came about because we just decided, I mean, number one, you know, in order to communicate with both our grantees and the people who fund us.
This was a better tool for doing that.
Right.
So what have you guys done since you've been online, or what are you doing with the online presence that is sort of creating a difference?
Well, one of the interesting things about Plowshares that's different from other foundations is that we're actually a public foundation, which means that we're supported by thousands of individuals all around the country.
Okay.
So we raise money from them,
right,
and then we give that money away. It's kind of like, you know, a modern-day Robin Hood, so to speak.
Exactly,
right. So what the web has enabled us to do is to really reach out to a much broader range of people to tell them about Plowshares, both educate them about the issues, because that's what our site tries to do, and then also give them a door to the many, many grantees that we fund.
Great. Okay, so in a sense, one of these, you're saying it's a fundraising tool, and it's an education tool as well. What are some of the organizations that you funded that you're particularly proud of?
Well, as I said, we fund a range of organizations working on peace and security issues. So that means nuclear weapons, nuclear terrorism, for example. And there's a terrific organization based in Washington, D.C. called the Center for Defense Information.
Okay.
What's interesting about them is they're actually a group of retired military officials that got together and decided that they want to work against nuclear proliferation. They want to decrease the military budget. And they have a fabulous website. I mean, a couple really fun things, like they have this running military spending clock that shows you kind of second by second how much we're spending.
Interesting. Which brings up an interesting topic of the fact that, you know, now that the government has stopped funding as much of the military in the past, there may be more things that people can do. What other organizations are you looking at?
that we fund?
Yeah.
Well, we fund a broad range, too. There are research organizations and then there are activist organizations. Mm-hmm. And one of the activist groups that we feel very proud of is a group called 2020 Vision. Mm-hmm. And this is a wonderful, easily accessible site where if you want to take a quick action on a peace issue, you know, stopping the arms trade to Indonesia, something like that, you go on their site and they'll tell you exactly who to write to, give you a couple tips on what to say, but then you can actually write your own email and send it off to your member of Congress.
Well, we'll have to go check them out online.
Do, definitely. Thanks. So, Mike, what's the deal? Why are veterans getting online these days?
I think it's just because it's available.
Mm-hmm.
The internet is a new technology, and there's a lot of hype in the news about internet. So people go online and they search for things that they are interested in. And one of the things is veterans. There's a lot of veterans.
Now, when I think about veterans, I typically think of older folks that served in World War I, World War II,
It's not the case. It follows the demographics of the internet. The reason that I started an internet website is because we were in Silicon Valley,
mm-hmm.
And I had an internet server, so I had the means, and I had joined VFW, so I put a notice up about when and where we have our meetings, and I read in the VFW National Magazine about one of my ship reunions, Turner Joy, and put a notice up about that. And then those have evolved into 2 years later what you see today.
So you've actually quite an extensive amount of information at your website outside of just the VFW meetings and when their reunions
right.
are and so forth. What are some of the other things you'll find?
There are a lot of there's a lot of information having to do with veterans or military war on the internet. It really kind of is in two veins. One is official government stuff,
mm-hmm.
And the other are individuals like myself who have access to the web and have started a website to provide information.
So when you set the website, you've got some interesting anecdotes of the ship stories. I think they were kind of interesting. Anyone that comes into your mind?
Yeah, on the Turner Joy, one of the shipmates sent me a story about when Turner Joy was at the end of the Vietnam War and was firing on the last day before the ceasefire, and the story about what they went through that night to keep the guns shooting, and one by one, there's three mounts on a destroyer like mm-hmm. Turner Joy, and one by one, the gun mounts developed problems, and they were down to just the last gun mount shooting in the last hour, and it had experienced difficulty also, and there's a crew in the gun mount, and one guy was having to kick the shells out with a broom handle while another fellow shorted two wires together to get the new shell to come in, and they proceeded firing like that during the last period, and the Turner Joy, they had timed the last shot had a flight time of 45 seconds, so they shot the last shot 45 seconds before the ceasefire deadline.
Wow.
And when they were done, they ended up with about three bullets left in the magazines.
So it really did represent the end of the Vietnam War.
Yes.
So there's some amazing stories. So there's a great reason for veterans to look to websites to find some community on their experiences. But I think it's also interesting that you've also got some great links for students as well. Is that right?
Right. And we had for veterans, this past Veterans Day, some students in Arcadia, California, Hugo Reed Elementary, fourth grade students, were learning about Veterans Day, and they each wrote a letter, and the teacher sent it to our post because she had learned about our post on the internet.
That's great stuff. Thanks, Mike.
So, Andrew, you got to see a kind of war site and a kind mm-hmm. of peace site, mm-hmm. as you suggested at the beginning of the show. What did you think?
I was drawn to the peace site, definitely, but I actually like the war site because I think, in a way, it may actually spread some peace.
Huh.
It's a real archive of the history of war, and one of my big fears is that people are going to forget that war happened or forget some of the atrocities.
And a lot of people really were never alive during
exactly,
a big
exactly.
war.
And so this way you can go on, you can see actual photos of of Hiroshima and things like that, and really it keeps it fresh. And
you're right, that history is important, I guess.
Yeah.
But Gene, what about, I mean, you talked to a guy afterward, a guy with these war games, I mean, where guys spend a lot of time in these simulated wars and war battles and pretending they're commanders and all that stuff.
Well, my first question is, what does his wife think about it, number one? But when you look at some of the stuff, it's incredibly detailed, incredibly intricate work, you know, the modeling and those types of things. Fascinating, but definitely something you'd have to spend a lot of hours doing.
Well, I guess there's an argument that if we have these hostile, warlike instincts, it's better to get them out in a game mode and battle on the internet than do it for real, huh?
Do it on the streets.
All right, War on the Web. We'll see you here again next week at the Internet Cafe.
NetCafe is made possible by RonDiamond.com, the oldies site on the internet. Music and memories from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, not just another jukebox. Additional support comes from the Law Offices of Ivan Hoffman, Lawyering with Integrity, for internet law, copyright, trademark, and other intellectual property law. And by TechWeb, for up-to-the-minute technology news.
To purchase a videotape copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify the show number and the topic.